Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest and you'd like to hear it narrated on this channel? Well, if so, send me an email with all the details. You can send the email to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hey there, Sasquatch. Listen up. You know, I've got an email for you tonight from a man named Josh who writes in to tell us about his encounters many years ago in South Carolina. So go on, get yourself some snackage, turn down the lights, and settle in for tonight's journey down into Sasquatch Valley. You ready? Me too. Let's go. This happened outside of McCormick, South Carolina, just a few miles from the Georgia border, which runs down the middle of the Savannah River. I lived there with my mom and stepdad. We had a mobile trailer home. To get to it, you had to go down a very long driveway that had white pines on either side of it. The driveway was gravel, and the pines were maybe 30 or 40 feet away from the driveway. Those pines were the front leading edge of a thick piece of woods that mostly belonged to our neighbor on one side of the property. Our slice on that side was the driveway to the front, and then a little extra into the woods on each side. This all started in January 1987. For Christmas, just a few weeks before, I had gotten a Sony Walkman cassette with FM radio. It was my prized gift that year. My mom and stepdad left for work before I had to leave for the bus stop at the end of the driveway. In January, the mornings were a blue dark at 6:30 a.m., just enough that I could see without an extra light. It was the first week back to school after the holidays. I had my Walkman earphones on, and I was listening to some kind of music as I walked down the driveway. It was dark, but not too dark to see. There was no other lighting from the house because I had to turn everything off before I left, and there was no lighting along the driveway. The only light came from a light pole all the way out by the road at the end of the driveway, and I mostly used that light as a guiding point as I walked. In my vision, I had the light at the end of the driveway. Everything else was blue or black. The area of the driveway between the trees was blue. The trees and everything else were completely black. I had walked down this way 1,000 times, and in all that time I'd only had one scare when I was much younger, and a deer came bolting out of the trees on one side. I remember that morning I was scared. I think I screamed and I jumped, and then when I saw what it was, I had a good laugh at myself, and I kept walking. This morning, I wasn't looking at anything particular as I walked, but I saw something move on the right side up ahead of me. I stopped and stared into that area. Something was wrong. I felt all prickly all over. I quickly turned the Walkman off and pulled my earphones down to my neck. I listened and stared hard at that area for about a minute. Just standing there, I had no idea what it was I had seen. But I knew that something had moved out from the darkness into the blue light area, and then it seemed to step right back into the darkness of the pines. I was about midway down the driveway. I felt the hairs on the back of my neck prickling again. My neck and face felt hot, like I was embarrassed. I didn't understand it at the time. I could hear the bus stopping down at a house up the road to pick up another kid, the same one that's always picked up right before me. I knew my stop was next. The engine's whine of that school bus and the squeal of the brakes were very distinctive. But I did not want to go down that driveway. But I knew I was going to be in very big trouble if I didn't get to school. So I bucked up and told myself to stop being silly. It was probably just a big deer or something. I didn't fear anything around there because the only thing anyone had ever warned me about since we lived there were snakes, and those are not a problem in January as a rule. I ran down that drive, though, faster than I thought I could go. I decided whatever it wasn't out to get me or to do me harm. I passed the place that I was sure I had seen something, and I started to run faster. It might have been my imagination, but I was pretty sure I saw some really big guy standing there. And when I passed him, he turned and started running alongside in the trees as well. I heard branches breaking, feet pounding on the cold ground. I thought I could hear it huffing its breath as it ran, but that might have been me hearing myself. I was about to hyperventilate. I almost did not stop at the road. I was so scared I almost went straight across. But it's a good thing I stopped. The bus was just pulling up to the stop there. I could have literally been hit by a bus that morning. At the end of the driveway, the pines tapered off way back from the road on both sides, so there's a really good line of sight as you're pulling in or pulling out of the driveway. When I got to the end of the drive, I had maybe 2 or 3 seconds until the door opened on the school bus. In that time, I turned back to look, and I swear, as the Lord is my witness, I saw a huge, hairy man about the size of Andre the Giant. It was standing between the last pines before the open space by the road. One arm was holding back some pine branches, while most of it was in shadow and covered with pine branches from the stomach down. I caught a fair glimpse of it from the light cast from the pole. I could not stop looking at it. Then I heard the bus driver yelling at me. I snapped to and got on the bus. I was too scared to tell anyone on the bus or at school that day. No one on the bus had seen it, or I'm sure someone would have said something. When I got home, I had to wait for a minute to get the courage to run down that driveway. But I did. Nothing was there either side all the way. I got inside the trailer, locked the doors, and waited for my mom and stepdad to get home. As soon as they got home, I blurted out with everything and told them what had happened. My mom blew it all off. She was sure I was mistaken about what I had seen. Billy, my stepdad, he listened to me, but he didn't exactly believe me either. I cannot describe the terror that I felt every single morning, knowing I had to walk down that driveway while it was still dark. Even if it had been light out, I did not want to walk down there. Before that, I had no fear in that area. I would spend an entire day horsing around in those woods an awful lot. The way the property lines were drawn on one side of the property, our trees went 200 feet away from the driveway, then went around the side of the house and opened up in the back to make a big square behind us. Then the property line came up close on the other side, about 100 feet from the house, and then narrowly sliced down up against our driveway to the road. When we moved there, Billy made sure to show me the tree marks he had made, because when it was surveyed at purchase, he came in a few feet all around those markers, and he put orange tape ties on all the trees so I would know. He did this and got the survey specifically because he had bought that property from a family member of his, and that elderly family member had warned him, the neighbor on the other side of that thin slice of trees along the driveway. He was a right royal you-know-what, and he was worse than ever now because he had wanted to buy that property for himself to make his property larger. And because of that, I was always extra respectful of the boundaries. So when Billy asked me to walk him through all that had happened that day, I did. He had me walk down the driveway and show him where I thought it had been. I knew Billy was thinking this was the doings of that crappy neighbor. But I told Billy, unless that guy suddenly grew to be the size of Andre the Giant, there's no way it was him. I tried to find a way to not walk down that driveway alone in those dark mornings, but the facts were that both Mom and Billy had to leave for work before my bus came. And while they could have driven me down to the end of the road there, I'd be standing out there for 45 minutes or more until the bus came along. So I would be standing out there alone in semi-darkness, and I had no reason to think that it wouldn't come out of the trees and get me as I stood alone by the side of the road waiting for the bus. So every morning, I ran the gauntlet of our driveway. Weeks went by, and I did not see that thing again. I almost had convinced myself that I really was mistaken over what I had seen, or maybe it really was that weird neighbor trying to frighten us. One morning, it was early February, I think. Mornings were still a dark blue, but getting a little lighter. I had begun to relax, but never again did I wear my Walkman outside again, and certainly I never wore it walking down the driveway. But as it happened, I got too relaxed and was lost in thought, walking with my head down. I looked up when I saw something off to the side of the driveway, moving. It was a thing I had seen before, but this time it wasn't facing me. I don't know if it was playing a type of possum to make me think it wasn't there or what, but it was standing, partway turned away from me, so I was mostly seeing its very broad backside. It was standing perfectly still. I was about 20 feet away from it. I panicked, but I made myself stay calm. I backed away as quietly as I could. I backed up down the driveway. I didn't know if it knew I was there or not, but I went under the presumption it knew I was there. I got so far away from it, and then I turned and ran all the way back home. I called my mom at work, and I told her what happened, and that I was staying at home. And like all moms everywhere in the universe, she was adamant that I was going to get my little butt out there before the bus got there, and I had better get my butt on the bus. So I told a white lie, and I told her the bus had already come and gone. And it really might had by that time, for all I knew. But there was no way I was going down that drive again. Now that was a Friday, and all weekend I caught a lot of flack from my mom. Billy, my stepdad, he never said anything to me as a rule about anything. That was my mother's rule because of her previous boyfriend that, well, he took being an authoritarian way too far, and he meddled where he shouldn't. Billy was respectful of my mother's wishes and did not try to discipline or really meddle with me at all. We coexisted peacefully. Now, there was a building that we called the shed, but it was more than a shed, but a little bit less than a barn. Well, this building is where Billy did a lot of his side work and hobbies. His hobby on the side was buying, restoring, and selling antique furniture and other odd things he would find. Now, he was way before his time. I know everyone does it now, but in 1987, it wasn't very common. The next night, after I saw it in the driveway, this would be a Saturday night, my mom was inside watching television, and I was in my room listening to music and trying to follow some directions in a book on how to paint with watercolors. That was another little Christmas gift, and I hadn't really touched it until then. I had the inkling that maybe I could try to paint what I saw. Maybe then people would believe me. Well, Billy had gone out that afternoon to work in the shed on some new stuff he'd picked up. Billy had rigged up some intercoms from Radio Shack that ran between the house and the shed. They were meant to be used inside room to room, or at least that's how Radio Shack sold them. But somehow, Billy had wired them up to be used between the two buildings, because again, back then there were no cell phones, and to run another line out to the shed would have cost a lot of money in the 1980s, so this was the solution. I was on my third attempt to sketch out some kind of a blob squatch to paint, when my bedroom door suddenly snapped open. I looked up in surprise because my mom did believe in knocking. I looked up, and then she looked at me surprised, as if she didn't expect me to be there. "Oh," she said, "you are here." I said, "Yeah, you saw me walk down here half an hour ago. Where'd you think I was?" She shook her head and didn't answer me. A second later, I heard her on the intercom say, "No, he's in his room. I just talked to him." I knew she was talking to Billy out in the shed, but I didn't know what was going on. I couldn't understand what he was saying on the intercom. A minute or so later, Billy came into the house, and he was fit to be tied. I heard him come down the hall to my room very quickly. My mom was behind him the whole way, saying things like, "I swear he never left. He's been here the whole time." Billy stood in my open doorway, and all he said to me was, "Tell me true, Josh. Were you just outside?" I looked up at him in total confusion. I said, "No." And then I pointed to my feet. They just had socks on them. My boots were in the living room, I said. It had been raining on and off, so they would have been wet. He can go check for himself. They're surely dry. Billy looked at me for a long second. Then he nodded and he said, "Okay, I'm sorry." And he held up his hands, turned, and walked out of the room. It turned out that someone had been out there while he was out there. They were banging on the shed walls and on the door while he was inside. Every time he'd go out to look, the banging stopped and no one was there. He would wait and nothing would happen. The minute he would go back inside or turn on a power tool, the pounding would start again. And then for a while it was rocks and other things hitting the roof of the shed, hitting the windows at the back, or hitting the walls. I don't know what was doing it, but it was not me. Now Sunday afternoon, the very next day, he's back out there at the shed again. He's out there all afternoon till it's dark and it's dinner time. Mom calls out to him on the intercom telling him to come in. It's about 6 o'clock and it's dark out. He closes the shed door and padlocks it. Then he turns around just as my mom flips on the back porch light for him to see to find his way into the back door. The light showed the same thing that I had described to him on Friday. A thing bigger than our fridge. A thing shaped and about sized like Andre the Giant, just covered in hair. It was standing right by his pickup that was parked off to the side of the porch area. It was taller than the cab top of his 1982 Ford F-150. He said shoulders and head were clear above the top of his truck. It turned away from the light, but it delayed moving away for a few seconds. Then Billy said he watched as it walked along the length of his truck and moved across the yard into the darkness and the woods that were there. From then on, neither Billy nor my mom doubted what I had seen. I had been afraid to say the word Bigfoot to either of them, but Billy nailed that one. He said it, so I didn't have to. As we all nervously ate dinner that night, one thing was unanimously decided, to my great relief. I was no longer to walk along that driveway on dark school mornings. My mom, after dinner, called the mother of one of my friends that night. She asked if she could drop me off at her house so that I could catch the bus with her son, my friend, in the mornings. It meant that I would be getting up an hour and a half earlier and out the door almost an hour earlier than I usually went. But it was worth it to not have to walk down that driveway. I don't remember the reason that she gave to her friend, but that's what we did for the rest of the school year. We agreed, the three of us, we would not be telling people in town about this. Who would believe us? I did catch sight of it again on one of those early mornings that my mom was taking me to my friend's house to catch the bus. We were going down the driveway as usual, and it suddenly, big as you please, walked right out into the middle of the driveway and stopped like a roadblock. It wasn't looking at us, though, but it did seem to be looking across to the other trees at something. My mom was looking at the one in the middle of the driveway, but for some reason, I looked over to where it was looking. I looked and looked, but I couldn't see anything over there. But all the same, I had the feeling there were more of them over there. "Back up! Back up!" I yelled to my mom. It took a second, but she snapped to and put the car in reverse and backed up all the way to the house. We waited a few minutes, then we headed down the driveway again, going slow and looking all the way. It wasn't there, so Mom gunned it down the rest of the driveway, and we peeled out onto the road. We were reading up on what we could about these creatures, but back then there was no internet to speak of. The only computer I had ever seen in my life in 1987 were a couple of Apple IIcs that the school kept in what they called computer carts, and they didn't connect out to anything. So the only information we had was what we found in books from libraries and a couple we found at a bookstore, and every now and then we'd see a documentary. We wondered at some points if what we saw was really a Bigfoot, because we didn't hear any yelling, we didn't have any weird smells, and we didn't have any of the other things that people were always reporting. We had strange sightings here and there, too, but not all of them were definitely the Bigfoot. My mom kept seeing it a lot while she stood doing dishes. She would look out back, and she said it would be leaning up against the shed or walking around. Billy always wore his gun in a holster now, just to go to the shed and back. The lengthening days that came with spring made us all very happy, as I'm sure you can imagine. The last time I saw it, it was a few days that I had to go back to walking down the driveway. You see, my friend's grandpa, the one that I had been going to meet the bus with every day, well, his grandpa died over in Georgia, so the whole family was gone most of that week over in Georgia. So I had no choice but to walk down the driveway again. But we all thought it would be okay because now it was May and the mornings were full of light from the rising sun. Just as before in January, it was there, waiting along the pines that lined the driveway. This was my best and closest look at it yet. It was the only clear look that I had of its face. It was lit up from the slanting sunlight. I don't think it realized that I could see it at first. If the sun hadn't hit it the way it had, I might have taken it for another tree, or part of a tree. It stood rock still, and it was looking past me like it was trying to not make eye contact with me, but still keeping me in the field of view. I could see that its face was covered everywhere in short hair except for the lips. The hair was shorter than anywhere else I could see on its body. It was the kind of short hair that you see on a dog's face or snout. The eyes were spaced far apart under a thick, bony brow. I stared at the eyes, but I did not feel that spark of eye-to-eye contact. I wondered if this was the same creature. This one seemed to be trying to melt into the background, unlike the previous times we had seen it. For the first time, I could see the oval shape of its head. For some reason, I hadn't noticed it before. But standing there in the morning light, I got a good look at this thing that had scared me to death. I realized suddenly that Andre the Giant was smaller than what I was looking at. I don't know how long I stood there. I was too scared to move. But there came a second where I realized I had better move. So I did what had worked before in January, and I started backing up slowly while keeping my eyes on it. As I did, I believe I had some of that eye-to-eye spark that I just mentioned. I had it just a little. I think it looked sideways at me. It didn't turn its head or body, but I think it slanted its eyes sideways at me to see what I was doing. Again, I came to a point where I could turn and run. I did so. I ran inside, locked the doors, called my mom at work. The difference this time was I got no flack from her at all. The rest of the week, she took 1 hour of personal time every day and drove me to school. I got to school about a half hour early, but it was still better to sit outside on the benches than to walk down that driveway. Now that summer I turned 16, and I had my driving permit before school started. Never again did I have to walk that driveway alone as I once had. there were other things during that year that we cannot explain. I hesitate to include them because they don't necessarily make sense. And I don't know that it was all Bigfoot. One night we woke up to the sound of glass tinkling, accompanied by a weird twanging metal sound as if it was being hit. In the morning, we found out that the motion lights that Billy had put up that spring all around the house and shed, as well as the little wrought iron lamp post in the yard, well, they had all been smashed. Billy theorized the weird metal sound was a rock being used to smash the wrought iron cage that held the light bulb in the lamp post. If you didn't know how to unscrew it from the top, you couldn't get to that light bulb. And that's what Billy thought it was after. It wanted to stop the lights. Of course, it could have been someone else who came all the way out from town just to do that. Sure. But why? Nothing else was ever bothered or taken. The bathroom window there had a frosted glass, pebbly-looking window. One morning, my mother was drying off after getting out of the shower, and she said she was sure that something had moved outside the window. Something had pressed itself up against the window. She screamed, and Billy came running. Billy asked what happened, and she told him. Billy asked, how could she be sure something was out there? It's dark outside. She was in a bright room. You can't see out there. But my mother insisted that she saw a color change out there against the glass. Well, it might have been the Bigfoot, and it might not have been. But the truth is, we all three were a bit paranoid for many months. There's so much more that I want to say about this, but I'm getting tired typing it all out. I was very happy when I got my first used car, a 1977 Pinto station wagon. You can laugh at it if you want. But me? I was thrilled. I no longer had to worry about being walked to the school bus by a Bigfoot. By fall, we realized we had not seen anything of it since the last time I saw it in May. We kept looking for it, but we all agreed we think it must have moved on. Billy said he had heard some strange stories out of Georgia lately, and there were some over there in South Carolina, Greenwood County. So maybe those stories, maybe they were about that Bigfoot. Over the years, I've tried to rationalize what it was doing there, what its motive was, what did it want. And even after all these years, I still have no answers. There was no pond or water source there. The food sources there were not particularly abundant. Sure, there were deer, and people had gardens, but the deer were not that ample, and simple deer fencing seemed to keep most critters out of the gardens. Maybe it came south for the winter, and it left before it got too miserable hot with all the fur that it had on it. Our trash was never bothered that I knew of, so it wasn't eating that. And we never heard of anyone's livestock or chicken or pets going missing, not at an abnormal rate anyway, or that could not somehow be accounted for. We have scratched our heads over the years, but the three of us agree on what we saw. Mom and Billy ended up moving to Louisiana in 1994 because Billy got a job on an offshore rig in the Gulf. Him and Mom are now both retired, and they've decided to stay on there in Lake Charles. I'm just now over in the state line in Beaumont, Texas, where they seem to tell tales of their own brand of Bigfoot. I haven't seen one. I hope I never do again. Thank you for reading this. Signed, Josh. All right, well, that was a pretty good email. I love getting those long emails with all kinds of details. I like knowing what people are thinking and feeling while these things are happening. I know I get a lot of comments about how people wish the writers would just hurry up and get to the Bigfoot. Just give me the bullet points of what's happening. And if you hear crinkling again, the cats are playing on their paper in here. Anyway, to all those people screaming, they just want to get straight to the Bigfoot. I just got one thing to say. Why don't you get yourself on up, get in the car, go down to Wendy's, get you a Frosty, come back, chill out with that Frosty, and just wait, okay? Just chill out, enjoy your Frosty. The Bigfoot's coming, okay? All right. If you want bullet point style, well, there are plenty of other people that do that out there. Now listen, some stories are so action-packed, Bigfoot, 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 and others are not. Me, I like them all. Well, listen, folks, I've chatted enough tonight. I think that's going to bring tonight to a close. You know, we'll be getting together again soon. And until then, you know what I'm going to say. Absence of proof is not proof of absence.